Good evening and welcome to First Issues. We live in a time in which technology has drastically changed the ways in which we interact professionally. Skype calls with colleagues in other towns and countries, team projects conducted using collaborative software, and financial transactions made at the push of a button. Despite these changes, the importance of good business etiquette remains, because at the end of that electronic cable is still a flesh and blood person. For the fresh graduate looking to get out into the world, or the overzealous first-time entrepreneur, overlooking the professional way in which things are done can cost them the very job, sale, or opportunity they are looking to get. A phone call placed outside working hours may harm a work relationship instead of building it. Thinking you can be more casual simply because you're using one of the many less formal electronic platforms now available can also paint you in a bad light. But beyond deciding whether or not to use a smiley in a formal communique, the unspoken rules of interaction extend to face-to-face communication as well. Are you presentable? Do you know what to say in which setting? Do you know to chew with your mouth closed at that lunch meeting? On the back of the Protocol, Etiquette and Diplomacy for Local Authority Executives workshop held in the first week of June, we had the opportunity to speak to the visiting consultant about business etiquette in an increasingly globalized world.
Business etiquette really refers to the forms of behavior and manners that are acceptable in a business setting, which I think are very important for every business person, but not just in business. You know, when you go to the government side, you talk of protocol, but in a business sense, you're talking of etiquette, which I think is very fundamentally important for every business person to have, particularly in this globalized village in which we live. So having said that, I think it is imperatively important that every entrepreneur understands how to behave when in the company of other guests, particularly international guests, and perhaps when we go outside Botswana to do business with people from other countries and so on, there should be, I should say, a standard way of behavior which is acceptable, which sort of creates that mutual understanding and respect, which can foster positive relationships as far as business is concerned.
Is it purely in the instance of one-on-one interactions, or does it extend to even electronic maybe, or other forms of communication that are commonly used in the business world that probably account for professionalism or levels of professionalism?
Not necessarily one-on-one alone. Remember, in business, image is everything. You know, it's about projecting the right image to your clients and prospective business partners. And nobody wants to deal with somebody who looks shabby or a company that looks unprofessional. When you send emails, they are all wrong spelling mistakes and so on, particularly for young entrepreneurs who are joining the business world. So I would like to think it's not just one-on-one. It goes to, you know, the way you present yourself as a person, but also the way we write documents, the way that we behave when we are at a business lunch. Such things like that, they form impressions. And as you were talking about in the program, first impressions really last a very long time. And you would want to make sure that the first impression that you create, particularly with potential business associates, is the right one. Because the impression that they have about you at first will determine if they want to deal with you in the future, because they also want to protect their brands.
You've mentioned that there's a particular or a right and wrong way to interact. But in this global world, there's so many different cultures. What may be right in one place is not particularly kosher in another. How do you navigate that? And can we solidly say there is a right and wrong way to go about doing things?
Let's say, for instance, you are a business person selling product A, you know. I would like to believe that even if you go to another country, say South Africa, or you go to Zambia or America, or you expand to Europe, surely you don't want to go there and impose the way you do things here, I mean there. You know the saying that when in Rome you do as the Romans do. Take for instance, you have someone who comes from Japan and they want to conduct business here. And they come here with their Japanese way of doing things, which might be anti-Tswana. Surely that person wouldn't be accepted. I mean, just by the way that they behave. So I would like to think that in as much as we have different cultures, the onus is on the business people to learn other cultures. So when they go to do business there, they understand how those people operate. They understand the dynamics that make that society tick. If I want to go to India, I got to understand how India works. If I want to go to America, I have to understand how the Americans work. That's the only way I can prosper in that business. Because remember, there are also organizations which are local, which exist there. And if I'm going to compete with them, this is the first point to start. You cannot go into a market and you don't understand the market itself, the dynamics that make up that market. Therefore, in as much as we have different cultures, it is imperative that we understand other people. Otherwise, you'll never be successful, trust me. If you want to go to Zimbabwe, understand the Zimbabwean people. You want to go to Nigeria, understand the Nigerian people. Then you can do business there. So you want to understand them and do it better than the locals. So you can become successful there.
What can be the detriment of a lack of business etiquette?
If you are going to get into business with someone, they want to know that I'm getting into business with someone who is well-cultured, who can represent our brand, or who I can partner with in my brand in such a way that won't bring my brand down. The detriment of having bad etiquette is just that you lose business. Nobody wants to deal with you. Why do we like Samsung? Why do we like Microsoft? Because the people who represent Microsoft are, you expect these well-groomed people who speak for the brand. And of course, the people and the brand together coming in, they form something phenomenal. So you can't just have a product. And I was telling the group that, you see now, we're getting into a period now where in the next few years, people are going to be selling products without the product itself. The person is the product. You are the brand. So, which means I can make a decision by just looking at you, by interacting with you for an hour, I may decide whether I want to buy your brand or not. So, if I am the brand, I want to make sure that I am well packaged. Now, I've had many people say, I don't really care what people think about me. And I said, that is very wrong. You should care what people think about you. Why do you think when you go for an interview, you look good? The idea is you want those people who are interviewing you to have a good impression about you. Same thing with branding. Same thing with etiquette. It's about creating the right image.
What has facilitated the shift, you say, where people will now be judging a product based on the personal representation? Has that not always been the case? What's causing this new way of doing business?
We have so many players in the industry right now. And because of so many players, there are so many things that you can use to judge whether a product is good or not. And remember, people are all over the world. I mean, if I am in Japan and you are here in Botswana, I'm not going to ask you to send me whatever you're selling first for me to have a look at it. I'm not going to travel all the way to come here to see something I want to buy online. I mean, you can just fly over. We have one-on-one meeting, and I can make my impression. I really want this thing. So for me, it is being caused by just the fast pace that globalization is happening, which makes people the center of everything. It's not really your product. How many phones are good? How many phones can do what Samsung can do? There are many of them. But you want the representatives of Samsung to give you that impression. So for me, it is because of competition and the fast pace that globalization is really expanding at.
We've spoken about how different places have different ways of doing things, but in this increasingly globalized world, I'm sure there are things that are pretty standard across the board with regards to business etiquette. What are the most common mistakes young business people make when they're trying to network or when they're trying to get into the scene?
Funny enough you say that, because in the program, I showed a clip when you were busy conducting, and I had some mistakes that young diplomats make. Very obvious ones. I mean, it's nothing out of this world, really. But you hear, for example, someone coming late for a business meeting. You know, we have this thing, particularly in Africa, we say we have African time. You know, some people say that there's no rush in Africa. We're already behind. But you see, when you are dealing with people from, you know, particularly civilized countries, that's one of the most important things. If you come late, nobody will take you seriously. So being late, coming to a business meeting shabbily dressed, I mean, you should dress well. Why should you dress well? To create that impression that we're talking to someone very serious here. But besides that, you must have technical expertise of the product that you're selling. So sometimes you find that particularly our young African men, our young African business people, he sets up a company, he understands the brand, then he just hires a few people, maybe school leavers, doesn't really educate them or doesn't really train them, and then he's put in a corner where these people are, all of a sudden they have to represent this brand. He hasn't even trained them. Can you see the challenge that's happening here? So before you hire people, many young African entrepreneurs, they don't understand that when you hire people, you train them to know what you want. It's like to know what you know. It's leadership. I read a book recently by a gentleman called John C. Maxwell. It's called The 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership. And one of the laws that he talks about there is a leader, it's called the law of the inner circle. And that law says a leader's potential is determined by those that are around him. Which means if I want to grow my business, I have to surround myself with people. If they are not experts, I have to make them experts. And remember, a good leader produces other leaders. So if I train my people to know what I know, let's say there are 10 of them, it means I have 10 me's there. So this is one of the biggest mistakes. I come in, I'm the only one who knows the business. I know the product very well, but I can't be everywhere at every other time. The other mistake that people make is, especially young entrepreneurs, is a lack of a proper preparation when you are setting up your business. But in terms of etiquette and protocol, remember, we've been talking about behavior. It's really about behavior. They just make so many stupid mistakes. I mean, we can count them one by one and we will not finish. But otherwise, there are so many that, remember, etiquette is not some sophisticated thing. It's really simple things, like I mentioned, on how to behave, what to do. When you meet people, you stand up, you give a firm handshake, show that you're confident about what you're talking about, look good. When you go for a business meeting, and you are in a business lunch and you are eating, eat properly. You don't want to be, you know, eating like a crazy guy who doesn't know what he's talking about. All those things create first impressions. And remember, before you talk business, you engage in these small things. And by the time you engage in these small things, by the time you start business, it might be that the person you're trying to deal with is already fed up with you, already doesn't want to deal with you. You're just going to talk, but he's already made up his mind about you. Doesn't want to do business with you anymore. So we don't want that. Let's create good relationships. Let's create good impressions, first and foremost, so we can pave the way for our good business talk.
When we return, my co-presenter Bonolo Malatsane takes us through our fourth installment in our food safety series, Microorganisms and Food.
Welcome back to First Issues and on to our second topic of discussion this evening. We have been running a food safety series in the past few weeks, acknowledging some of the associated human and economic costs, especially to developing economies such as our own and the continued need for people to understand the importance of the matter. Locally, we can point to incidents such as the loss of 500 infants in Soroe as a result of contaminated water. Our guest this evening, food safety specialist Nina Hamid, also points out that this is an important issue to Botswana, specifically as tourism and hospitality is the second biggest income generator in the country. She says since the financial crunch, this country has had little resources to equip environmental health officers to do their job and ensure that the food we consume is safe. And although in contrast, our eating establishments have grown exponentially in that time. Nina has, however, dedicated years into educating those within the industry as to the proper handling of food. From food vendors to ministers, she says. and thus makes for the perfect person to speak to on this matter. Food can be contaminated by chemicals, as we have discussed before. Physically, like when you find a piece of hair or glass or anything that is not supposed to be in there, and by microorganisms. Nina picks up our conversation at this point, telling us what we need to know about microorganisms, both bacterial and microbial and foods.
Let me start off by saying that food safety is an important aspect, and all our food naturally contains bacteria. But certain of the food poisoning bacteria, we need to know which ones they are and which foods they relate to. So there are many causes of food poisoning or food contamination, and I think the chemical and metal ones have already been covered. So today we'll concentrate more on the microbial ones. First of all, you can't look out for them because bacteria, microorganisms are not visible with our naked eye. And the reason why the bacterial food poisoning is important or is of concern is because the food can appear and taste and look absolutely normal. Smell and everything is nice, but it could be heavily contaminated with the food poisoning bacteria. So those are the ones that we have to be aware of, because for the general public, they cannot go out and say, I'm not going to buy this because it might have salmonella bacteria in it or clostridium or this and that. So relating them to the types of food. So if I start off that by saying that not all bacteria are harmful, some of them are actually used for producing some of our foods like yogurts and cheeses, and also for making antibiotics and medication like penicillin and so on. Those are made from the good bacteria. And then we also have some bacteria which cause food spoilage, where you can physically see the mold growth or the off smell, the off taste, you know, those kind of physical signs you can see. So the ones that we have to concern with are the ones that I call the bad ones. And these ones can be found in foods which are high in protein content. So you're talking about your raw meats and poultry and chicken and fish, lamb, pork, you know, all those products. And they're also found in the raw vegetables, because bacteria are found in the soil. So anything that grows above the ground or below the ground will contain food poisoning bacteria. And if these foods are not handled correctly from the purchasing stage through to the consumer eating it, along all the steps, we have to take precautions to avoid food contamination, food poisoning taking place.
What can be the direct results of ignoring the recommended good food safety practices?
With regards to the bacterial food contamination, it affects loads of us. In fact, all of us have had some form of food poisoning at some stage or other, because if you've had vomiting or diarrhea at any stage, it is a mild case of food poisoning. Some people get it more severe. They can even end up in hospital, and we've also had deaths due to food poisoning. If I can mention the incident where we had quite a few babies who died due to the water contamination and getting diarrhea. Children get dehydrated very quickly. So if they've got vomiting or diarrhea, it can lead to death very easily unless they get, you know, treatment immediately of rehydration. And then the elderly, because as we get older, we start losing our immune system as well. So we can't fight off the infections as easily. And if they have any other kind of medical condition, for example, if they're a heart patient and they've got the stress of vomiting and diarrhea and fever and temperature, it can lead to a heart attack and they could die due to that. And thirdly, if you have an compromised immune system due to, you know, not being fit and healthy or having some sort of a medical condition, having had an accident or been for an operation, or even if you've got flu symptoms, if you eat contaminated food, then it can be quite severe for those people. So instead of getting healthy, they can become worse. And that's how we need to ensure that the food they're consuming is safe.
Which foods are commonly connected to specific bacteria? And what are the risks of improperly handling said foods?
We have certain bacteria which can grow on the food and can release the toxin or the poison. And others which sort of get carried along with the food or the drink. So we call them food poisoning bacteria and foodborne diseases. So the food poisoning bacteria examples are salmonella. Salmonella is found in poultry, in meat, in eggs, and other sort of products as well. But those are the main causes, main types of products that you can find Salmonella bacteria present. And there's no rule to say that if Salmonella is present on poultry, that there can't be some other bacteria present on there as well. For example, Clostridium perfringens, it's also found on meat and poultry and so on. And then you have another name, Bacillus cereus, which is usually found on rice and grains. And most people don't regard rice as a high-risk food, but if you see incidences after large functions such as funerals and weddings, usually people get food poisoning and the cause may be the rice rather than anything else. And then we also have Clostridium botulinum, which is related to poor canning production, tin production, you know, tin foods. It has improved, but that's if you get Clostridium botulinum food poisoning, that causes death almost immediately because it affects the nervous system. So some of them are quite severe. The ones that release the poison directly onto the food when we consume it, we're going to get vomiting taking place first. And then there's others that get ingested, and when they get into our stomach, that's when they start releasing the poison. That's when you get the stomach cramps and the diarrhea taking place. Some of these bacteria can also cause permanent damage. Like if you get E. coli food poisoning, it actually affects your kidneys, and you'd end up with kidney dialysis treatment because you get kidney failure. And the foodborne diseases, examples of those are like TB. TB is bacteria found in the ground, in the soil, and also in water, contaminated waters. So if the cattle are grazing and feeding off that contaminated land, they're going to get the TB bacteria. And if we don't have pasteurized milk or heat-treated milk, if we drink raw milk, we can get the TB bacteria or infection into us as well. And then there's things like typhoid and diphtheria. All those hepatitis are viral or microbial contaminants, which don't need large numbers to cause us to be ill, but the length and duration of the illness is longer. Whereas with food poisoning, usually it's between 6 to 72 hours that we get the symptoms, and we can recover from that as well.
As we near the end of our series on food safety, we will now share some of the practices that we must all become conversant in as we realize that this is a matter that can become one of life and death. From myself, Bonolo Moletsane, the rest of the First Issues crew, our valued sponsor First National Bank, we wish you a pleasant evening and pleasant viewing.